Here you go, buddy. I'll write them down.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Let's try that again. Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm getting hard to hear. Not really. I have selective hearing. Myra knows about that, don't she? It's a man thing. Did everybody get a good nap this afternoon?
No. No.
Not everybody had a good nap.
We didn't have a nap.
But then, you just rested just enough then to just stand with us and just praise the Lord together. For those of you that are sitting up front in church, turn around, look over here.
Amen.
Welcome. And then I have to point you out. And even if it is just for a brief visit, it's good to see you tonight. We love you, sister. And I just wanted everybody to be able to share in the joy to see you and see your coming in.
Amen. Amen. Isn't it good to see family back together?
Amen.
Yeah, it's good to be here. It's good to be here. I can tell you for a fact now, it is different being at home or being in the church. Yes. Okay? I've done the experiment.
The hard way.
the hard way. And I can tell you, laying on a bed, running to the bathroom in between times, is not a good way to watch service or be in service. It's good to be here, and like you say, that little twinge of seeing Pepper and Tom come in, you know, it today has kind of reminded me of a time back when Roger and I were not Christians, and our pastor had a tree fall across his lap and break both of his legs. And he was a one-armed man. And so all the people, you know, immediately, all the doctors and places at that time said, well, he's done, he'll never preach again. Just count him out. And, you know, he won't even be able to get up and walk. And there was just all these horrible prognoses that came out. And Bragg and early one Sunday morning, Dad showed up at the house and he said, you kids need to take me to the hospital today. But I need to go talk to Brother Mac. So the Lord has shown me that he'll be back in the pulpit by so-and-so. And I need to go tell him that the Lord's told me that. And we, of course, drove Dad to the hospital and enjoyed seeing Brother Mac, but they had his legs all fastened up and pins in them and weights on them, and it didn't look bad. It looked horrible. And knowing he had the one arm to get up again. But then about 3 months later, one night in the service, the back doors opened just about like then, and a pair of crutches started down the aisle, and Brother Maggard was back in his church. Preached 40 years after that. You know, the devil likes to count us out. But again, tonight I want us to remember he is a nobody. He's a nobody headed for no place. Let us pray. Father, it's with joy tonight that we are gathered in your house. I think probably there's been times we've gathered out of duty, out of it's what we do, it's what we want to do, it's the life we live, it's the way we want to live. Sometimes I think we gather without the joy, just simply because of the wear and tear on us of living in this world. But I think tonight we've gathered with joy. We're glad to be in your house, and we're glad to be a family. We know there are those who are joining us by other methods. We're aware of them, and we're glad they are with us. We realize they are fighting their battles and catching glimpses of the church, as we have been doing. And we don't discount that at all, Lord, but it sure is nice to be in the house. Bless us tonight, and let your blessings go through every crack and cranny of technology today to find the hearts that need it the most. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We're going to do things just a little different tonight. We're going to do our announcements and our prayer requests in different order so we can allow some singing to happen tonight. We're just going to share some local voices and just praise the Lord and just enjoy fellowship together tonight. So if you're looking at the prayer request, kids prayer next Sunday, and then the 10th and 11th yard sale. And those of you that need to help or want to help, I'm sure they'll make all the help they need. They've got some, look like gathering some really nice things over there just from when I saw it over there today. So that would be a great yard sale, and they work so hard at that. And sometimes we, you know, we have other thoughts about things, but you know, the truth is ministry goes on no matter how each individual feels. Just praise the Lord for that. Ash Wednesday is February 22nd. We'll begin our 40-day fast. Jam on the 22nd also. And then March 21st, the baby shower for Christiana, so just a few things going on.
Brother Mike, can I interrupt you just a second? We're going to have a makeup jam this coming Saturday from 3 to 4, 4:30.
This coming Saturday from 3 to...
Yeah, a makeup for what we had to miss last week.
Okay. So that's going to be a makeup from the what we missed last week.
Mm-hmm.
This coming Saturday, it's
3 to 4:30.
Okay. So.
That just was decided today.
Those kids get excited about that, don't they?
Yes, they do.
And, you know, Brother Mike, while we're on that subject, I think it would be good to have a little celebration. I think there was 11 children here this morning.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There was 11 downstairs, and there was 3 or 4 up here still. So there was a bunch of kids here this morning.
Had a good turnout and good service too.
Just praise the Lord for them, because the children, those ones that's coming behind us, that's what's going to keep these doors open in the
future.
Need to just pour into those young people. It was good to see some, even the team up here today, come and join with us. And it makes everything so much better to just see that. You know, the churches, that's how you know the church is healthy, when you see not just us old folks, but some young folks and some middle age, and just a good mix. We'll ask the ushers if they'll come up with this evening's tithes and offerings. And while they're coming, we'll just ask the Lord's blessing upon us. Father, it is good to be in your house once again. It's wonderful to be able to gather with your people in friendship and fellowship. Mostly, Lord, just to come and praise your name. Lord, we ask now that you would just bless this offering. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Strains muscles in his back, and that's a recurring thing for him. He said he'll be doing fine, and then when you think you're doing fine, you do something that you think you can do, but you probably shouldn't, and there you go again. So remember him in prayer tonight. Remember Arnold Underwood as he goes through his testing and deciding what to do for his care. And remember the family as well. It takes a lot. If you ask Roger or anybody that's Pepper that's cared for sick loved ones, and Daryl, and we've all, a lot of us have been through that, it takes a lot. So remember the families as well. Shirley Prater, I guess she's in rehab, and Russell Rose is now in rehab, and he had a stroke, and they found that tumor. I don't know if they made a decision to do with that yet or not. Pepper's dad's been moved to rehab. I guess he's doing well.
He is doing phenomenal. Is that by himself? Takes a walk in the halls and sits in the chairs.
Awesome.
So I would predict it won't be too long, much longer before he's home.
Praise the Lord.
Then something to praise and look for.
Amen.
Amen.
Can I give you an update on Randy's dad? They took him to hospital the other night, and he's got needing. They were going to do emergency gallbladder surgery, and one lung was completely full of fluid. He was in congestive heart failure, and they told him unless he got any stronger, even if he got rid of it, he probably wouldn't survive the surgery. And if he don't get the surgery, it's not looking good. So he's down to about 150 pounds now, And he's fell the evening they brought him back from the hospital, and he fell again today. So they're doing the best they can, but when somebody's dead weight, it just, you do the best you can. But they all need prayer, spiritually and physically.
So remember Randy's dad and Randy. You know, that was another one of those conversations we had the other day about being away. Sometimes it doesn't take much to get you out of that. Oh, I hate to use that word habit, coming to church, but it is. You miss a couple of services, and then you start finding excuses to miss another. It's hard. And it's hard to get back. God is good, isn't he?
Right.
He doesn't leave us, he doesn't let us go too far. And he always calls us back to himself. And,
I'm going for a stress test on Tuesday morning today for him.
So they're going to check Sarah for the stress test and see if she still has a heart. And Barb's preparing for cataract surgery, and I guess Mindy, they're looking, going to a podiatrist to see why the bones in her feet keep breaking, and so she's not looking forward to that. She told us this morning that the children's is looking into changing Brody's surgeon because it seems like he's just so busy or dragging his feet or whatever. They're looking for somebody to come in and address that situation. So we're continuing to pray for that. But there's a lot going on just in not a small group. And just pray for each other. Keep reaching out with each other. That's one of the things that I've noticed, especially in the last few months, is how much you guys care for each other. And I saw somebody say, well, have you heard from them? And I'll say, well, I haven't had a chance to call them today. Well, I called them this morning. So they know. they've been watching too. So just take care of each other.
Shannon's also having surgery Tuesday.
Yeah, Shannon's having another graft surgery Tuesday. And I think she told Myra that she thought they might send her home towards the weekend if everything went well. So
that's what I heard, but I don't know until the day comes, do we?
Yeah, so.
We're going to pray that.
There's been a serious burn, and it takes a long time to heal. Any other requests?
Mike, I've had a serious eczema flare-up, and I need to get into a doctor to take care of that, so I can appreciate prayer. It's the worst one I've ever had, so.
So let's remember. Pepper. Family seems like it's just been going through one thing after the other. Carol's has an MRI coming up, and so they can tell her what they're going to do with their left shoulder. And hopefully they do the MRI on the right shoulder. That's, you got to talk to Daryl about that one.
Right now, they're not going to do the right shoulder.
They're going to be the right shoulder, which is the wrong shoulder. Well, there's no other request, and stand with us, and we'll sing a prayer for us. We'll ask our pastor to return for prayer.
Hearing just a partial list of things that are concerning just these few people that are in the house right now. And if we could hear from those that are tuning in, we would hear an even larger list. If you sat with each of us, Lord, you would hear us mention many, many, many more things. When we talk with you on our own, and we not only talk about the church and the family and the community, the nation, but Lord, we talk to you about the things like our families and the needs to see them grow spiritually. We talk to you about spiritual issues, and we mention things that we don't mention in public, things that people are going through, and battles, and perhaps dementia, and things that are happening within the minds and the hearts and the lives that we don't always bring out in public. We are a people with a lot of need, and we have you, Lord, a Lord who can meet every need. Help us, Lord, to talk with you. I'm thinking today, Lord, about the mother that said, I've never been able to talk to my daughter-in-law about the Lord. But now the daughter-in-law is in trouble and unable to go to work, unable to get out. And now the door was opened. She said, well, I sit and talk to myself. But the mother-in-law was able to say, do you know Jesus is right there? You can talk to him? Sometimes, Lord, you take our troubles and you turn them into opportunities for us to learn and for us to share you. Give us wisdom, Lord. Give us wisdom to get our foot in every door where your name can be mentioned. Touch every need, Lord. Touch every need. You said to the Apostle Paul, when he said, there's a messenger of Satan and he's slapping me about. Paul came back again, Father, here I am again. That messenger of Satan, he's really buffing me. And he came back the third time, Father, I've mentioned to you over and over about this messenger of Satan who's beating me up. And the Lord said, I'm not going to take him away. Because, Paul, I give you so many revelations that you can get puffed up. You can perhaps fail spiritually. So I'll just give you grace for the journey. Lord, whether you fix a problem or whether you give grace, the solution is at hand. Help us to believe you will be here with answers. And help us behave seemingly while we wait. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I still had a heart. Thought that comes to my mind is, I don't have a heart anymore. I gave it to Jesus quite a while ago.
Amen. Amen.
I love the Lord tonight. And it's good, you know, it's good to see Pastor back on the platform. But it's good to see Pepper back. It's good to see everybody here. You know, when we come in, the devil just wants us to be so down, trotted down, and, you know, wants us to down. But it's good to see everybody here, and it's good that we can laugh. We don't have to come in here and sit like some sour mule out in the field. We can have fun in church the same as we can anywhere else, and sometimes it's better fun anyway.
Thank you. I love the Lord. Already this service has been a blessing. I'm just thankful for everything that the Lord's done for me. And if I didn't know it before, I know now when I decided I wanted to come back home, I was able to find a way to get here. And I just praise Him.
Thank you. and I drop all my burdens, and I run straight to Him. And then I feel the freedom I've never felt before. Satan might have got me lost, but Jesus got me home. Yes, Satan might have got me lost, but Jesus got me home.
When the dark I've been going through some tough times. But God brings me through them. I've lost a brother. I got one in hospice. But God's going to bring me through.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God is good.
All the time.
Oh,
Amen. You all know how I love to laugh. I just have always loved to laugh, and I've always laughed in the wrong places many times, to my mother's exasperation. But you know, I was in a store. I bought a visual aid tonight. I don't know. Some of you may have seen this picture. Maybe some of you haven't. But I found it in a store one time, and I was so glad to see it. Can y'all see it back there? Do you know what it is? It's Jesus laughing. Did you ever see that picture? How many have seen this picture before? He's got his head thrown back and he's laughing. And I thought, boy, that's how I see Jesus. Bible says he was acquainted with grief. You see that, Daniel? The Bible says he was a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. But I believe Jesus knew how to laugh and have a good time. And I'm sure his disciples did. We know he went to weddings. And I'm sure that he wasn't a drag sitting over there with no smile on his face. So, and then somebody wrote a song about it. That funny guy on with the Gaithers, Mark Lowry. Yeah. He wrote a song about Jesus laughing. So that was my visual aid for my song. So you listen to the words of the song. He will be laughing. So I hope you'll see Jesus in a different way tonight. Also, he says, Sister Wilma, he is our refuge and our strength and our constant help in times of trouble. And that's what this song is about. You listen to the words of it too. That music's too loud. Tell me and I'll tell Daniel.
Every time.
friend of mine one time, not too long ago, told me the mark of a good pastor or a moderator is knowing to hush. So this evening, I promised the pastor he'd give her some time. So I'm going to hush. And I'm going to ask you to just come and just bring the word of whatever's on your heart.
That was certainly one of the pieces of advice that I was given in ministry. My old mentor used to say, have a good beginning and a good ending and keep them close together. He used to also say, don't give a big bucket of milk and then stay in the pulpit long enough to kick it over. I have, I guess, a testimony done mixed with word, but I feel like tonight that I just wanted to share with you some things that I know. I want to read one verse of scripture. It's in Daniel, you'll recognize it. Daniel 3:25. He answered and said, lo, I see four men, loose, walking in the midst of the fire, and they have no hurt, and the form of the fourth is like the Son of God. If I were going to title what I'm going to tell you tonight, it would be what the Lord gave me, and that is, the Lord shows up.
Amen.
The Lord shows up. There are about four truths that the Lord has brought to me through this time. I guess you would say that on the 30th of December, I faced something I never ever thought of. It was never in my thinking. I'll soon be 78 years old, and I never once thought that you'd bury an immediate member of my family and I wouldn't be able to go in any way. I never thought I'd have a sister 77 plus years, and there'd come a day that all of her funeral arrangements, I just would not be able enough to go. But my family and everybody else came in and did what needed to be done. All the family went. And that day was one of the sickest days. I was about the sixth or seventh day in a hospital stay. I finally became in such a shape that I just had to go to the hospital for help. And this was about the sixth or seventh day of the stay that her funeral was. And it was a very, very sick day. I don't like to say this, but most of you know one of the byproducts of chemo and radiation and all that is diarrhea. And probably to the tune of 30 to 40 times. I was completely, there was nothing left in me as a person. It had just gone until I was thinking, if something doesn't change in the next few hours to days, I'm going to see the Lord. That's just the way it is. I'm getting ready to leave here. And as all of the family came in after the funeral and visited for a while and got ready to leave, I actually thought when they left, I'd be saying goodbye to them very soon. But I never said anything to them. And as that evening went into the night, I grew weaker and weaker. A silly little thing had happened with the IV, and I couldn't use this arm to add to even more, trying to get up and out with one arm. And you could just feel within your spirit that things were becoming very critical. But I had no fear. I remember that calmness that was over me. And some of the young nurses, and of course several of them knew me, and they mentioned the calmness. And I said, yes, the Lord's in the room. He's here. I don't know what he's gonna do, but he's here. And I fell asleep sometime about 10 or 11 o'clock. I don't know, it was, I call it a sleep. I think it was a vision in a way. And a very strange thing happened. Vicki has an aunt that's, what, 94? 94 years old. And I probably haven't been with her personally in 20 years. She's a beautiful lady, loves all kinds of pretty colors. She was, without my knowing it, also very critically ill that night, somewhere up in Ohio. Well, in my vision, I was with Audra all of a sudden. And Audra and I were outside death's door. I mean, just there we were. We were outside death's door. And the devil came. And the devil began to tell us, you two old women, look at you. You can't even walk across the floor. He's particularly said that to me. You can no longer walk across the floor. Well, Audra looked up at him and she said, devil, you're a liar. And I want to tell you something else, devil. You have to operate on ignorance. You have no power except people who are ignorant. And neither of us are ignorant. We both know Jesus. And you just need to know you have no power. You have no power unless you can get people to believe you are somebody. And she just told him really straight. Well, by then, somehow I got my voice, and I told him, she's right. You do not have any control. You can't take our life. You're standing here telling us you can take our lives. You don't. You can't take our life. You have no power. You're just waiting on your time in a lake of fire. If we leave here, it'll be because the Lord calls our name. And if we stay, it'll be because the Lord said you can stay. And you just need to know you need to leave. I've told you that before, and even though I can't walk across the floor, I can also tell you I've got more power than you do because I know Jesus. Leave. The next thing I knew, I woke up and it was 12:05. And I looked up at the clock, and that same feeling that when I got saved, when I got sanctified, there was a feeling to come over me that I knew the Lord had come. I knew that he was in the room.
Amen.
I knew that I knew that I knew. And a little bit the nurse came in and I said, I'm going to get better. The Lord's not going to take me now. I'm going to get better. Well, the night pretty well went like every other night. But by noon the next day, they dismissed me because things had changed. And I knew for a fact that the Lord wanted me to witness that. He wanted people to know and to understand. Not that you don't know that, you do. But there are so many people that don't really realize. The devil does just have to operate on ignorance and lies.
Okay.
He does not have any control.
Right.
It's up to the Lord what happens. Well, we came home and pretty much trudged through the next 2 or 3 weeks. And it was rough trudging. But one Wednesday night, when you all were having church, and I had saved one of the church services I hadn't got to see yet, and I put it up on the TV there in my bedroom. Just put the service up on the TV and was watching it. And I fell asleep. And when I woke up, I had my hand in the air declaring that the Lord had touched me.
Amen.
And I knew again the Lord was in the room. I continued to raise my hand and to praise him, and I knew that he had touched me again, and I began to be able to eat food. I began to be able to just take a few bites of food and be able to eat. And then one more time, the Lord came back, and that was one day last week, and I told Roger, I said, today the Lord gave me some devotions on giants, and he's given me the Easter Lenten series, and he's beginning to speak word to me now.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
I learned some things that I already knew, but I learned them by experience. You know, there's things you know in your head that you know that you know that you know. But once you've lived through something, the Lord showed up for me when I had no power over any of that. But just like in this Bible, from beginning to end, whether it was the three Hebrew children, whether it was Esther, whether it was any character, the Lord shows up. You think of the times in your life that the devil tried to convince you you were a goner. For whatever ways and in whatever, hasn't he tried to tell you that about your families? He's tried to tell you that about your church. He tries to tell you that about a mistake you made or the talk that you handled, you too much talk. Or how many times does he come and he tries to cripple us? But he has no power except if he can talk us into believing that he has power. He cannot take our soul. Mm-hmm. He cannot condemn us before the throne. He has to deal in ignorance and in lies. And when the Lord shows up, mm-hmm. You think of what the Lord has done in this book, and there's no way to even begin to say it, but you think of how many times in this book it tells about the Lord showing up. And when he shows up, I mean, all he had to do was come in that room.
Okay.
And by noon, I was a different person. I mean, we know that we have to leave this world. There comes a time that he's not going here. There's going to come a time that I'm going to leave, just like for the rest of my family. I'm now the last one of my immediate family that I was born in. All of them are gone. And there will come a day that the name Wilma will be called. But that doesn't mean he won't show up. He'll show up then to take me home.
Right.
He'll still be showing up. Even though we think of death as leaving this world, that is our destiny, is to drop this old body of clay. It's not what we, he gave us life and he gave us to fight for life. But there comes a day in everybody's life that it's time to go home. And we don't know when that day's coming.
Right.
But when the Lord comes in the room, four things that I learned that I know and want to witness and want people to understand. One, he shows up. He just came. People, he just came. Now, I don't know who of you or who prayed through on that. I can tell you I wasn't able to pray. Somebody prayed and Jesus came to see me. Amen. Now, is that not powerful? Another thing is that the devil cannot, he has no power except you believe his ignorance and his lies. Thirdly, we need to trust the Lord completely. Amen. Now there's rough times. We've all been witnessing rough times. There's a lot of things been going on in people's lives in the last 2 or 3 years. A time like no time we've ever lived in. And it seems like we're bombarded with troubles. We need to trust the Lord 100%. Amen. And the last truth that I want to share is, if your relationship with Jesus Christ is 100%, you are the richest person in the world. Amen. If your relationship with Jesus is 100%, there is nothing going to happen to you that you and he together can't handle.
Amen.
I know those are simple truths that you've heard, you know, but I just wanted to share with you, I've lived through them. I've lived through them. I wish I could make you feel and understand what it felt like to wake up and to know that the Lord had come in the room and had said, I loosed that, Wilma. I've loosed where you've been. You're not there anymore.
Hallelujah.
People, we have a Lord that we need to share more and more every day.
Right.
Our families need to know that we trust our Lord. When Chad was talking today about your funeral, that you want your family to know. I want my family to know my trust was in the Lord Jesus Christ. And that I believe he has all power in heaven and in earth. And whatever he says to happen today or tomorrow, whether I like it or not, I'll say, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I challenge you tonight, as we close, to really let the Lord be Lord. Don't doubt him. Don't let the devil, let's not give the devil that kind of permission. Let's put him off our land and off our stuff. Let's notify him. We know you deal in ignorance. We know that, and we're not ignorant. You cannot deal with me like you do the person that doesn't know the Bible, because I know the Bible. This is a sword. And you cannot come past it. As we get a song tonight, I know that there are lots of battles going on in your lives too. I know that. You've all been witnessing those things. Just declare to him again that you love him and that your allegiance is with him. I am going to believe in you and I'm going to trust you, Jesus. And if anybody needs to make that, to talk with him up here, come up here and do it. But make that allegiance to him. I know you are the Lord. I'm aware of who the devil is. I'm not going to deal in ignorance. I'm not going to deal in lies. I'm going to deal in the Word of God with the Lord Jesus Christ personally. And wherever he leads, that'll be fine with me. Tonight, if you have something on your heart to pray about, you come and pray, or pray where you are. But if you have things that he's beating you, the devil beats you about, I thought about how in an hour's time, the devil's hand was totally loosed. Totally loosed. Now, the battle wasn't over, but the battle had been pronounced over. Do you know what I'm saying? You know, you're still fighting the battle, but you know the Lord's already said, it's okay. You all understand that, don't you? Praise the Lord. You understand that, yeah. That he come and he said, I've been here. Now you fight on till you get there, but I've already pronounced it. Tonight, if there's something on your heart, come and talk to the Lord or talk to him where you are.
Thank you.
up. When he shows up, think about it. As you read through this Bible, start thinking about the times you see Jesus show up. And everything is different from there on. Go ahead.
I say we stand. Open your funnels tonight.
Amen.
And let the Lord just pour into you tonight.
Amen.
I said, well, son, I've been at death's door tonight, and I've been delivered from death's door tonight, and I think the main thing you need to worry about is how is your soul with the Lord Jesus Christ, and all else will be taken care of. He said, I like that answer. I don't know what he did with it, but that's what we... If he gives us a chance, let's talk about Jesus. Let's let everybody know. Let's let our families know we trust Jesus. I know we do, but let's do it. Let's let them know it. Let's find a way. Let's pray until the Lord gives us a voice. That we can let our people know it's real. And you've got to have the goods to go to heaven. It's not a game that you play. God bless you tonight. I love you. Thank you for letting me come back in this frail shape. Let's take this spirit with us.
Praise the Lord. I've been to church tonight.